So there are four types of chemical reactions, but we need to know something here before we proceed. So in this presentation, we're going to look at some elements and how they exist here. So when we've got one type of element, we need to investigate that a little bit further. So elements can exist in two different ways. Firstly, they can exist as a singular atom, like most things on our periodic table. So a lot of metals and even a few non-metals as well. So that's one way an element can exist on its own. The other way is as a diatomic gas. So the Hober-Finkel gases. So we have to consider this as we are creating compounds in this video. So we're going to look at decomposition next here. And in simplest terms, it's a compound that breaks down into its atoms. So we can represent that with compound AB, and all we need to do is we need to write the two letters that make up the compound as singular elements, and we also do need to consult the diatomic gas list to consider if either of these will need a 2. So let's go ahead and take a look at an example here. So let's create a balanced equation for the following, and we're going to make sure we name everything. So we have aluminum sulfide. So what we need to do first is write our two elements. We need to think about, are either of these on the diatomic gas list? And neither of them are. So then it just becomes a matter of balancing the equation. So we've got two aluminums here. We'll put a 2 in front, and that gives us 2 aluminums. And we have 3 sulfurs here, and that gives us 3 sulfurs. So this one is balanced. Of course, the last thing we'll do is name everything. Aluminum sulfide, aluminum metal. And we do put the word metal after these. And they're by themselves, and then sulfur. We don't say sulfur non-metal, we just say sulfur. So let's take a look at another example here. So again, we're going to create a balanced equation, and we're going to name everything. And this time we're starting with aluminum chloride. So step one says that we write the two atoms of the compound. So that would be aluminum and chlorine. Our next step is that we need to check or consult the diatomic gas list, and here they are. So are either of the elements that we just wrote down on the diatomic gas list? Well, yeah, chlorine is on the diatomic gas list right here, Cl2. So all we need to do next is make that into a 2. So that should satisfy step 2. Aluminum's not on the list, so we won't make that into Al2. Step 3 says we need to balance our equation. Now we do need to be careful with this one. On the right hand side we've got 2 chlorines, and on the left hand side here we have 3 chlorines. And so it's kind of like saying 2 times 3 is 6. We want to get 6 chlorines on either side. So what number do we need to put in front of Cl2 to give us 6 in total? Well, that's going to be a 3. And then we're going to look back at the other side here, and it already did appear. But we need to put a 2 in front because that will multiply out to give us 6 chlorines on the left-hand side. And let's not forget now that we also have 2 aluminums here. So what number do we need to put in front of that? Well, it's going to be a 2. And let's make sure we go ahead and name everything. So we have aluminum chloride here, aluminum metal, and chlorine gas. This is one of the few times that we can actually incorporate a covalent compound into our four types of reactions. So we do have a covalent compound written here. So we recall that we're going to have a different naming convention in the end. Step one says we write out our two atoms. So this compound is made of sulfur and oxygen. We'll consult the diatomic gas list. Step two. And sure enough, we have oxygen on here. So we'll make this into O2. And sulfur is not on there, so we'll move on to step three, which says balance. Now we need to be careful here with the balancing because we have 2 oxygens on this side and 5 on that side. So again, it's 2 times 5 equals 10. So we want to get 10 oxygens on either side. So what number are we going to put in front of this O2 to give us 10? Well, it should be a 5. And then over to the other side here, we already have 5. So what number do we need to put in front to multiply up to 10? Well, that's going to be a 2. And so that has balanced the oxygens. And then we just do need to realize that we've got 6 sulfurs in total here. It's not addition, it's multiplication, and a 6 there. And then we need to name it. Now let's be careful with the naming because it's covalent. So this compound here is made up of 3 sulfurs. So we're going to call that a trisulfur. And then the next part would be the 5 oxygens. So that's pentoxide. And then that one's just sulfur. And that one is just oxygen gas. So, something that happens though is with these decomposition ones, and here was our definition from earlier. We've got a compound breaking up into its atoms, but what can actually happen though is a compound can actually break up into two smaller compounds. For instance, we've got carbonic acid, and it actually breaks up into water and carbon dioxide. But the fact remains that we would only know how to determine our products in this case if we actually conducted an experiment and then interpreted the results. So there wouldn't really be a way for us to figure this out using pen and paper, what exactly it's decomposing into. Okay, so let's take a look at our third type here, which is synthesis. So this is, well, it's essentially the opposite of a decomposition. So now we've got two atoms combining to make one compound. So this time we have A plus B. And note that AB is created using the crossover method. So technically, we would have to think about the crossover method, what our charges were to come up with the correct formula there. And really, what we're doing here with this compound is we're just kind of doing what we were doing before with our crossover method. So we'll consider that as we proceed. So let's create a balanced equation for the following. Be sure to name all compounds. So we've got sodium plus phosphorus. So on the edge of our side of our page or wherever you want, you can say, okay, we've got sodium, we'll look up its charge, which is plus one, and you consult the periodic table and you get phosphorus and it has a charge of minus three. So how many sodiums are we gonna get? Well, we're gonna get three of them. And how many phosphoruses are we gonna get? Yeah, it looks like we're just gonna get one of them. So this is gonna be the compound that we're gonna put up into this spot here. There we go. Then it'll be a matter of balancing. This one should be pretty easy to balance. We've got three sodiums here, and we have one sodium there. So what value do we want to put, or what number, what coefficient do we want to put in front of the sodium? Well, it should be a three. And then it's just a matter of naming everything. So sodium metal, phosphorus, and sodium phosphide. Let's try this again with perhaps a slightly more complicated one. Now we've got lithium and chlorine. So we look up our charges. Lithium has a charge of plus one, and chlorine has a charge of minus one. So actually, this one's nice and simple. It's just LiCl. So we'll write that in. Then we've got some balancing to do. We've got two chlorines here and one chlorine on that side. So what value do we need in front? Well, we need a two. And I guess now we also have two lithiums. And so what do we need in front of lithium there? We would actually need a two. Maybe we should write one in. There's a two. And then we go ahead and name everything lithium metal and chlorine gas. Oh, there's my two.